Hi everyone, today at our seminar we have Matan Kraus from Bar-Ilan University. Matan, please start.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. So I'm going to talk here about the population protocol model and about the majority problem in this model. This is a joint work with Stav Binon, Tzvi Kopelovich, and Eli Porat from Bar-Ilan University. So what is the population protocol model? It's a pretty new and nice and cool model. It has n nodes in the system, and on each round, two nodes are chosen, and they can communicate with each other. How do we choose the two nodes? There is a scheduler that decides which two nodes will communicate in this round or in this interaction. And in our setting, the scheduler works uniformly at random. You just pick randomly two nodes and let them communicate. What do we mean by communicate? Each node has its own state. They can observe each other state and update their own state accordingly. So, for example, here these two nodes are chosen by the scheduler, and then these two, and then these two, and so on and so forth. In the majority problem, each node has an initial color, whether it's black or white. And we want all the nodes to know, to report the initial majority color. So, for example, here in the initial color was there were 8 black nodes and 5 white nodes. Therefore, we want all the nodes to report that black was the majority color. So how do we measure the efficiency here? We have two measurements. Small number of interactions until stabilization. What do we mean by that? On each interaction, for each node, there is a state, and the state has an output, which is black or white. So here, each node outputs, the black node outputs black, and the white node outputs white. We want all the nodes to output black. The number of interactions until all the nodes output black, report black, is what we want to bound here. Also, when we say stabilization, we mean first all the nodes agree on the majority, and first and second, none of them can get back to a wrong answer. None of them can get back to a white guess. We'll see some examples as we go ahead, but feel free to stop me whenever you want and ask whatever you want. Also, we want to bound the number of states per node. Typically, we want at most a Poi logarithmic number of states for each node. So we'll go through 5 protocols. We'll start with the ambassador protocol, which is very efficient in the number of states of one state per node. However, it takes a lot of time, n squared log n interactions until we can have stabilization. Just want to point out that stabilization can bounded only with high probability. We can't deterministically say that after so many interactions, we have stabilization, since the scheduler picks the two nodes at random. So it might pick the same two nodes over and over again. It will have no help for us. So we'll bound the number of the interactions only with high probability or in expectation. So the person of the protocol is very, very slow, but is very efficient in the number of states. We'll then continue to build et al. Protocol, which is way faster, but does needs a logarithmic, polylogarithmic number of states. We'll briefly talk about Alistar et al. Improvement in the number of states. Then we'll go on to Benwick et al. Improvement and then to ours from POTSI 20. So let's start as a warm up. Yes.
What do we know about lower bounds here?
There is a lower bound of log n states. We need, if we want n log n interactions, we probably need the log n states. There is a kind of a lower bound. It's under some conditions, but we believe we can't get better than log n and n log n.
Okay.
N log n is a trivial lower bound for the number of interactions. Of course, we can't get better than n log n interaction because just a broadcast here takes n log n due to some coupon collector arguments. Okay. So let's, as a warm-up, let's start with the ambassador protocol. In the ambassador protocol, we have only four possible states. Black and big, black and small, white and big, white and small. So off one states per node. And the initial state, so in the beginning, all the nodes are big, as you can see here. And the color is due to the input. A black node is black and the white node is white. And the transition function here is very simple. We have only three rules, as you can see up here. And let's talk about the transition function, about the rules. The first rule is kind of cancellation rule, I would say. When two opposite big nodes interact, they kind of cancel each other into small nodes. And the second, the third rule is when big node interacts with a small node, it colors the small node in its color. So when a big black node interacts with a small white node, it colors the small white node in black. By the first rule, after enough interactions, there will be no more a big minority. So in our example, after enough interactions, all the big white nodes will interact with a big black node. They will all interact with them and will cancel out, will get smaller. And then we will have only big black nodes in the system. So let's see how it happens, just like this. No more big small nodes, big white nodes, and there are still three big black nodes. Meanwhile, of course, the second and the third rules can still apply, and due to them, the white node here might become black because it interacts with a big black node, and also the big black node here became white because it interacted sometime with a big white node. But we don't care about this. When we'll get to the point where all the minority big nodes, where all the white nodes, big white nodes in our case, got smaller and we have only majority big nodes, only black big nodes, we can, after enough interactions, all the small white nodes will also be colored in black, as you can see here, due to the second rule here. And therefore, after enough interactions in the old protocol, all the nodes will get black, and they will report the true answer, which is black was the majority initial color.
So do I understand correctly that for the other possible pairs, you just don't change the states of the nodes?
Didn't understand the question.
So for other possible pairs, like, for example,
Yes. If a big black node interacts with a big black node, nothing happens.
Okay.
And, yes, of course. And little small white and small black, nothing happens. Yes, that's correct. Okay. So the complexity of this protocol, it has O of one states per node, which is a Cartesian product of the number of colors, which is two colors, and the number of sizes, which are, there are two sizes. We have two times two is four. And however, this protocol is very slow. Some kind of coupon collector arguments. We want all the pairs to appear. We will wait in the worst case until the last small, last big, last small white node will interact with the last big black node. We need all the pairs to interact, and by coupon collect kind of coupon collector arguments, it's a n squared log n squared, which is a O of n squared log n interactions with high probability and in expectation. So this is the first protocol, just as a warm up. Let's continue to Bilke et al. Protocol. So he offered the, I think it was the first, I'm not sure, the cancellations and the duplications framework. The idea is as follows. The protocol has is divided into log n phases, phase after phase after phase. On each phase, each node has theta of log n interactions. So how does a node know how to, that it know it needs to proceed to the next phase? It counts until theta of log n, until 5 log n, and then it proceeds to the next phase, and again, again, again. So each node has its own counter to know on which phase it should be. Each phase has two stages, a cancellation stage and a duplication stage. In the cancellation stage, when two different color nodes in the cancellation stage interact, they cancel each other into empty colors. It's a harder cancellation than before. They really cancel each other. So if a white and black nodes in the cancellation stage interact, they both become empty color nodes. In the second stage of a phase, in the duplication stage, when a colored node interact with an empty color node, it duplicates itself into the empty color node. As you can see here, when a white node interacts with an empty color node, they both become white. The empty color node becomes white. This happens only once per stage. So if this white node, when it interacts with an empty color node, it duplicates, but this node and this node, which is the same node, but after the interactions, they cannot duplicate anymore. So this node cannot find another empty color and duplicate into the empty color node. They have a flag that you cannot duplicate in this current stage, in this current phase. That's the idea. Before we analyze why it work, I want to talk about the synchronization here. So as we said, on each phase, every node needs to have theta of log n interactions. So it has a counter that counts until theta of log n. But we do need all the nodes to be in the same stage, in the same phase and in the same stage, because two nodes from different stages or different phases cannot interact. We need both of the nodes to be in the cancellation stage in order to do a cancellation, and also for the duplication stage. We want all the nodes to share the same stage. How can we promise that? So the idea is pretty similar to the Bose and Beam problem, which I you probably know, that where you have n bins, and you just start to throw balls into these bins. Here you have n nodes, and on each round you throw two balls into the two nodes that the scheduler chose. So in the balls and bins, by arguments from the balls and bins, you can see that the nodes are relatively synchronized. The difference between the node that is the most advanced and the node is that the least advanced can be theta of log n. After, let's say, n log n, of n log n interactions, the difference between the most advanced and the least advanced is theta of log n. And therefore, if we have long enough phases, we can promise that for long enough time, for long enough interactions, they are all share the same stage and the same phase, of course. This is not good enough because we have more than n log n interaction in the whole protocol. And therefore, they added a pull-up mechanism that when a node, the first node that finishes a phase, he broadcasts to all the other nodes to come over to the next phase, to jump to the next phase, and then the synchronized again. So again, on n log n interaction, it's pretty synchronized, and between phase to phase, we pull up the nodes that are still behind to join the next phase. That's the idea, and they showed that it's enough for the nodes to be in the same stage for enough time. I just want to say that in our solution we don't need the pull-up mechanism, and only the way of counting is enough for the synchronization. Okay. So why it works? First, we want to claim that after a cancellation stage, most of the nodes are empty. All there are no minority nodes. So when I say most of the nodes are empty, I mean let's say 70% of the nodes have no color after a cancellation stage. So when I say after cancellation stage, I mean let's say when the first node leaves the cancellation stage. So 70% of the nodes are empty, or that we have no minority nodes. Why is it true? If we have less than 30% colored nodes, so we got most of the nodes are empty and we finished. Otherwise, we have at least 15% of the nodes that have the majority color, let's say black. We have 15% of the nodes are black during all the cancellation stage. And then a node from the minority, a white node in our example, has a constant probability to meet with a black node and get canceled. And if it has theta of log n interactions in a cancellation stage, then with high probability, it will find a black node and will get canceled. So that's the idea. This idea in the cancellation stage. And in duplication stage, all the colored nodes with high probability, of course, all these slides are just with high probability. We cannot guarantee. All the colored nodes will get duplicate if most of the nodes were empty. So if 70% of the nodes were empty in the end of the cancellation stage, all the colored nodes, all the black and white nodes, will get their duplication once, as I said before. Why is that true? Similar to what we said before, there are enough empty nodes. There will always be at least 40%, I think, at least 40% empty nodes. So the probability to interact with an empty node is constant. And therefore, in theta of log n interactions with high probability, a colored node will get duplicated. So what do we have here? I want to talk about the difference between the minority and the majority. During the cancellation stage, the difference between the majority and the minority doesn't change. If it was 5, it will remain 5. Cancellation doesn't change the difference. However, if the duplication stage worked just fine, the difference between white node and black nodes doubles. Let's believe it by an example. Here in the left side, it's the configuration before the duplication stage. We had two more majorities and minority, and after the duplication stage, we have four more majorities and than minority. The difference doubles if the duplication worked just fine. So, after all log n phases, we cannot have any more minority color nodes in the system, because the difference gets doubled again and again. After log n phases, the difference is n, which means we have no more minority color nodes in the system, in the nodes. Okay. The complexity of this protocol is as follows. We have n nodes. Each node has log n phases, and on each phase, at most log n phases, and on each phase, it has data of log n interactions. So the number of interactions in the whole protocol is O of n log n log n, n log squared n interactions until you get to stabilization, with high probability, of course, only with high probability. If we fail, if something here didn't work as desired, we can know it, and then we can apply the ambassador protocol as a backup protocol. But I don't want to dive into this. The number of states here is the Cartesian product of log n times log n times c. So we have log n possible phases, and we have log n possible steps in a phase, and we also have a constant number numbers that of flags, and to know if I had a duplication or to know what is my color that helps me in the protocol. The number of states here is O of log squared n per node. The improvement, I'll briefly speak about the improvement of Eisenstach et al. To the number of states per node. So as we said before, we have log squared n states per node, because each node needs to know on which phase it is, which is log n, and on which step in a phase is it, which is another log n. It's a Cartesian product, so it's log n times log n, it's log squared n. Eisenstach's idea was to divide the population, the information between the population. So some of the nodes will know on which phase we are, and some of the nodes will know on which step in a phase we are. The nodes that know on which phase we are called workers, and the nodes that know on which step in a phase we are called clocks. We will have theta of log n clocks, theta of n clocks, and theta of n workers. How do we have theta of n clocks and theta of n workers? I don't want to explain this, maybe later on, but there is a way. And then the clocks only count steps on each phase, and a clock just know if we are in the duplication stage or in the cancellation stage, and the number of states per clock node is O of log n, because it's only counts steps. It's just, imagine a round clock that when the time is until 6, we are in the cancellation stage, and from 6 to 12, we are in the duplication stage. And how do we keep them synchronized? So as I said before, they are not strictly synchronized, they are not work together, but they are enough synchronized for us. And workers, they execute our cancellation duplication framework. Clocks don't have the color. They somehow canceled the color and they have no color. Workers implement the cancellation duplication framework, and they need to know on which phase they are, in the first phase, second phase, and so on, but they don't know on which step in a phase they are. So how do they know if they should cancel now or duplicate now? They ask a clock. When they interact the clock, they know on which stage they should be. They know if the time is between 12 to 6, they should be in the cancellation stage. And if they meet a clock again and they see if the time is between 6 to 12, they should be in the duplication stage, and so on.
Do you assume that there is some gap between the number of white and black nodes, or the difference can be even one?
The gap can be even one. It cannot be zero.
Mm-hmm. But sure.
Yeah, but it works off even if the gap is one.
Okay, nice. And the reason why I'm asking is because of this synchronization, which works for most of them, but not for all of them. So there's the reason why I'm asking that you need some gap.
With high probability, all the nodes will get duplicated in the duplication stage. If all the nodes, and that happens with high probability, if all the nodes get duplicate, so the gap one becomes two, and then becomes four.
Thank you.
You only need to worry about low probability events that something goes out of sync.
But if you need something goes out of sync, I can tell that that happens. There is a way to know that something went wrong, and then I just use the ambassador protocol. Okay.
Thanks.
So I can handle the low probability case. Okay. So the number of states per worker is also of log n. Just need to know on which stage it is or which phase it is, but not the step in a stage or the step in a phase. Now let's talk about the kind of recent improvement by Berendick et al. Their idea was to have shorter phases. When we have shorter phases of theta of log to the 1 minus an interactions per node, where a will be decided later, but I'm going to tell you it's one third. It's a third. When the phases are too short, we cannot guarantee anymore that all the nodes get duplicate. Regarding the cancellation stage, where we said that most of the nodes will get canceled, that is still guaranteed. They have some smarter proof that the cancellation stage still works as they wanted. Still 70% of the nodes will get canceled. But we can't guarantee anymore that all the nodes with high probability will participate in the duplication, because the phases are too short. Therefore, they introduce an out-of-sync node, which means a node that didn't participate in duplication. A colored node, a white node, or a black node that didn't participate in duplication in a phase. And we need to handle this out-of-sync nodes somehow. And the idea is to, after log to the an short phases, such a short phases, to add another long phase, a long catch-up phase, where all the nodes that didn't manage to participate in the duplication can duplicate there. We'll try to explain this more in a minute. And such a sequence of log to the AN phases and additional catch-up long phase is called an epoch. It's a new word, epoch. So how does it look like? Something like that. On each epoch, each row here is an epoch. We have a log to the AN short phases, followed by a long catch-up phase. Each short phase is composed by a cancellation duplication stages, and just as we said before, and then a catch-up phase where all the out-of-sync nodes can duplicate sufficiently. I'll explain what do I mean by duplicate sufficiently in a minute. Let's talk about complexity. So the number of phases that we need in the protocol is log n phases, log n good phases, of course. And here the phases are not so good because not all the nodes will get duplicated, but thanks to the catch-up phase, we can assume that the phases were good phases. So we need log n phases because we want 1 to become 2, to become 4, and so on. And each phase is now pretty short, which only log to the 1 minus a n interactions per node per stage. And therefore, we have a log n time log to the 1 minus a n interactions per node in the protocol until there will be no more minority nodes in the system. So that's a complex note regarding complexity. Notice also that each node here has log n interactions per node. Yeah, log n interactions in the catch-up phase and log n interactions in all the short phases together. And that's about complexity. So what do I mean that by saying that in the catch-up phase, all the out-of-sync node get duplicate sufficiently? So let's talk about the best case first. The best case is where a node didn't duplicate in the last short phase. A node that didn't duplicate in the last short phase just move on to the catch-up phase and duplicate. And that's it, we get back to a normal state, to a normal configuration. However, the worst case is where a node didn't duplicate already in the first short phase. For such a node, it should have duplicated into two nodes here in the first short phase. And if it would proceed to the next phase, it should have duplicated into four nodes and then eight nodes and so on and so forth. It should have duplicated into two to the log to the A N nodes in the catch-up phase. And that's what we want such a node to do, to have a sufficient number of duplication, a lot of duplications in the catch-up phase. Let's analyze the number of duplications that needed to be done in a catch-up phase, in one catch-up phase. This is this phrase. Let's divide it to four parts. First is the part in the parentheses. The probability to become an out-of-sync node in a single phase, in a single short phase, is this term. We'll discuss this term later. Okay, but it is this term. So the expected number, and also with our ability, number of nodes that don't duplicate in one phase is this term times n. So this for one phase. The number of phases in an epoch is log to the a n. So this is the number of nodes that got out of sync during the whole epoch until the catch-up phase. And each node, how many duplications does it need to have in the catch-up phase Well, let's take the worst case case, where the worst case, where the node didn't duplicate in the first short phase. We'll give all the nodes the worst case case, and which is 2 to the log to the a n duplications in the catch-up phase. Yes.
This is or this is spread across many nodes, right?
I'm sorry, I don't hear you well.
So because this is there is like this avalanche effect that a node should have duplicated. And it's the duplicate should have duplicated once more. So this is like a 2 to the log to the A. But this is spread across many nodes, the number of the applications.
The number of the application?
The number of duplications that needs to be done.
Number of duplications that need to be done for a node that didn't duplicate in the first show phase is this number.
Yes, but this is spread across many nodes. This is there is
yeah. It's also the number of nodes that
duplication.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So a white node will become a in the case that didn't duplicate here will become two white nodes, and the number of edges in the binary tree is also 2 to the log to the a n. Yes. So this is the number of duplications that need to be done in the catch-up phase with high probability and in expectation. This phrase, you can check it if you want, is a little O of n for a at most third, okay? And Berenbeck et al. Proved that if the number of duplications that need to be done in the catch-up phase is little o of n, then with high probability, they will all duplicate sufficiently. It's a pretty tricky proof, but it's fine, it's not too hard. But they proved that if there are not too many duplications, only little o of n, then with high probability, they will all manage to duplicate. Thanks to the fact that in the catch-up phase, most of the nodes are still empty. So after each epoch, we can assume that we had a log to the a n good phases. So what's the complexity of the thought protocol? We need log n phases, which are O of log to the 1 minus a n epochs. When we set a to be third, it's O of n log to the 5/3 n interactions until stabilization with high probability and expectation. We need the log squared n states per node, but again, to know on which phase I am, on which epoch I am, which step in the phase and epoch I am, it gets to log squared n, but again, it can be reduced to O of log n by distributing the information into clocks and the workers. Okay. So let's proceed to our solution. And the idea is to talk about the probability to become out of sync. So there are two reasons for a node to become out of sync during a duplication stage of a short phase. The first reason is the reason that we talked about before, I think. If the short phase, if the phase is too short, and we the colored node, the black node, didn't have enough interactions to meet an empty color node, so the probability to meet an empty color node is constant, but a node has only log to the 1 minus a n interactions during the during the duplication stage. So the probability to interact, to not interact at all with an empty color nodes is a constant to the power of log to the 1 minus an. And therefore, the expected number of such nodes is n over 2 to the theta of log to the 1 minus an nodes. So that's the first reason, which I don't want to deal with. I cannot improve this. The second reason is due to the deviation reason. So as I said before, an interactions occur only when the two nodes are in the same stage of the same phase. When nodes from different stages or different phases interact, nothing happens. So the synchronization here is crucial. So let's look at the here. When most of the nodes are here in the, let's say, in the cancellation stage, there are still quite a few nodes that are still behind or just ahead. And all of the interactions of this node, nodes that are behind of most of the nodes, are idle, have no meaning. So let's think of a node that is in the duplication stage, but it's too far ahead of all the nodes. On each of its interaction, it interacts with a node from a previous stage or previous phase, and nothing happened. It just wastes its duplication stage. So this is the deviation reasons. Nodes that are too far from the most of the nodes, and they don't duplicate due to the idle interactions. They prove that the number of nodes that don't duplicate due to the deviation reason is this term. Notice the 1 minus 2a here. And we improved here it to be 1 minus a. How did we do that? We sharpen the curve. So the vast majority of the nodes are tightened together in the same stage, and there are only a very few nodes that are too far ahead or too far behind. That's the idea. That's the idea. And now that I'll talk in a minute how do we do that, but if we have this, then the complex phrases that we have now here 1 minus a, and therefore we can set a to be half, and therefore the complexity of the protocol will be n log to the 1.5 n interactions until stabilization. And what is the trick here? To use a power of two choices counters. So before our protocol, how do nodes increment their counters? Just by interactions. When they interact with the node, they both increment their counters, as you can see here. The power of two strategy, only one of the nodes interact its counter. Which one? The node with the smaller counter. So here, x is smaller than x plus c for a positive c. And therefore, only x increment its counter, but x plus c stay with the counter x plus c. That is the power of two choices by Azar et al. So now we cannot maybe call the counter. It's a bound on the number of directions that a node had, but it doesn't really matter. Okay. So Berenbeck, in an old article from Stoke 2000, proved that the number of nodes that are too far away from the average, for most of the nodes, And when I say too far ahead, I mean at least a stage away from most of the nodes. Okay? Because if you are not a stage away, so then you can be in the same stage as all the other nodes. The number of nodes that are at least a stage away from the most of from the average is the desired term of n over 2 to the theta of log to the 1 minus a n nodes with half probability, of course. So this is what we wanted. And therefore, we have n log to the 3 halves n interactions until stabilization. Again, we had log squared n states per node because we have square root of log n states to count epochs, square root of log n states to count phases in an epoch, and so on. Another problem that we had is how to reduce this into O of log n interactions, O of log n states per node. We did wanted to use Alistair et al. Protocol, but it wasn't straightforward how to use it in our case. And also we wanted to deal with symmetric interactions, to have symmetric interactions. What do I mean by that? So what happens in case of a tie? In Azar et al. Strategy and the power of two strategy, you just pick one of the bins, one of the nodes, and increment this node. So in our case, just increment the initiator. Imagine there is an initiator and there is a responder node. They have a name. I'm the initiator. I'm the responder. Increment the initiator in case of a tie. However, if you want the interactions to be symmetric, not to have any a known initiator and a known responder, we cannot use this method. So to solve this problem, there is a way, a common way, to use random coins, but we didn't want to use it because we had some problems with analysis, and I think we had a smoother idea, and the idea was to use the left strategy by Voking. Okay. So we do want clocks and workers, as we said before in Alistair et al. Protocol, and the clocks will execute the left strategy by Voking. Okay, so what is the left strategy? I hope you know why you remember the bins and balls problem, but here the bins are divided into two groups. There is the left group and the right group. Each bin is in the left group or in the right group. On each allocation, a bin from the left and a bin from the right are chosen. The ball is allocated into the bin with the fewer balls, but in case of a tie, we allocate the ball to the bin from group left. We proved that this strategy is just as good as the power of two choices strategy. It still have the same bounds, and still we have very few nodes that are too far from the average. So we are fine in that case. And how do we make clocks? So we want exactly half of the clock nodes to be left, and exactly half of the clocks to be in the right group. How can we assure this? So how do we create clocks? Maybe we'll talk about how do we create clocks in the beginning. In the beginning, all the nodes don't have their workers or clocks. They don't know yet if they are workers or clocks. When two nodes from opposite colors interact for the first time, they both become clocks. This only happens if it's both of the nodes first time. First interaction for the black node and first interaction for the white node. if they both interact for the first time, the black node becomes in group left and the white node becomes a group right. That's the way we make clocks. I think you can easily see that the number of clocks in the left group equals the number of the clocks in the right group. And the interaction is just as we said before. If one clock has a smaller counter, it increments the smaller counter. And if there is a tie, we increment the clock from a group left, from the blue group, which is left here. How do we, an interaction between two nodes from the same side, to a left node, or to a white, to a right node, nothing happens. Nothing happens, we just do nothing. To conclude, the complexity of our protocol is as follows. It has O of n times log to the 3 over 2n interactions. And we have O of log n states per node. The workers only deal with, the workers only need to know on which epoch we are and how many duplications do I still have in the epoch. And the clocks only need to know, the clocks only count the number of steps in an epoch. Okay, so they know on which phase in an epoch we are, and on which step in a phase of an epoch we are. So that's it. Thank you very much. If you have any question, feel free to ask.
Thanks for a nice talk.
Sure.
Is there any reason to believe that this is tight, or one can push it?
We have a reason to believe that it is not tight, but we have very hard. We have some ideas of how to improve this into the kind of tight log n, but we're still missing something.
I mean, this looks like a limit of this particular technique.
Yeah, I agree. It's going to be some. I think that the idea briefly is not to have phases anymore. Make it all in once somehow. But we'll see.
If I might add a comment, conceptually, there was this breakthrough in population protocols with introduction of clocks and introduction of synchronization, which allowed for all of those fast and small space algorithms for majority in the leader election, which is essentially going into n polylog n interactions and polylogarithmic number of states. But we have reached the limits of those techniques. I mean, this is already stretching it by making a very short phases. This is something I am surprised to see that it's possible, that you can change the synchronization procedure.
Exactly. I agree.
And the general feeling is that to go beyond it, you need to discard the synchronicity at all and just go fully asynchronous.
That's true.
Yeah, it indeed feels that at least one fraction of the nodes, they will be progressing synchronous by the problem itself. Like if you have a large fraction of nodes just processing, progressing in the same phase, like to choose them randomly, there is very high chance to hit them without need for these inputs.
I'm not sure what did you propose.
I'm saying that even if you don't have these extra methods, when you're trying to make sure that everything is following the same epoch and so on, And if you have that sufficient fraction of nodes, they might be in there on their local clocks. They might be in different stages, but if sufficient fraction of nodes are one stage, having the whole system, even if you choose two nodes randomly, it's very likely that you choose from the same bucket and then they will progress. I think the nodes, if the number of such nodes may be super small and they're behind, hopefully they don't affect everything by too much.
I agree.
Okay, if there are no more questions, I mean, I don't want to stretch the talk for too long. I'll stop the recording, and then maybe if people are still interested, we can ask more.